Hey folks, the show's about to begin, but I wanted to let you know how you can help support Matt's Basement Workshop. It's simple. The next time you buy something for your shop, consider using the affiliate links at mattsbasementworkshop.com. While buying something for your next project, you can be helping the show. For more information, look for the Help Support MBW box on our homepage. Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. One of the shelf units I need to build for this project isn't quite as straightforward as the others. In fact, it threw me for quite a curve. Okay, all bad puns aside, I need to cut the curves for this corner unit's shelves, and all seven of them, three fixed and four adjustable, need to be done. Now, preferably, I wanted a way that would make the process as easy to duplicate as possible, but without spending too much time in the process. Once I figured out what that process was, I created the first of the seven. So now it was time to repeat it on the remaining six, and here's what I did to get this curve. First of all, I want all the straight lines leading into the curve to be as straight and square as possible. The easiest way to do this in my shop is with the table saw. This can be a dangerous set of cuts, so please be extremely careful if you repeat this process that I'm about to show. Start by raising the blade as high as it'll go. I feed the stock slowly into the blade with the top face up. I then cut as close to the beginning of the curve as I can get without the blade cutting too far forward on the bottom face. Trust your instincts on this. You'll know when it's too far. At this point, stop feeding the stock into the blade, but don't pull it out yet. Firmly hold the shelf in place, and then carefully turn off the motor and wait for the blade to come to a complete stop. Next, slide the shelf out and then readjust the rip fence for the next cut. It's important to pay attention to where you're going to be placing that blade. With our first cut, we were to the left of the line. Now with the second cut, we're going to be to the right of the line. Typically, we're removing material to the left, so pay extra close attention to make sure that you're going to make the cut to the right. Once the fence is in position and the blade is lined up correctly, we make our cut, repeating the previous cut. Again, make sure we stop short of the curve, and then stop the blade and wait for it to stop spinning before removing the material. The final result should look something like this. Two cuts stop before the bend of the curve at either end. Now, there are a couple of ways we can cut the curve, and we'll talk about those in the second half of today's show, but the method I decided on was to use my jigsaw. With a nice sharp blade and a good feed rate, you'll find you can make very clean, but more importantly, accurate curved cuts with very little cleanup in the end. Especially if you're making seven shelves, that gives you quite the opportunity to get some practice in. Now once the cut is complete, it's over to the bench, and then time to grab my favorite rasp, which is the Nicholson number 49, which I use to even the surfaces where the two saw cuts meet. Now unfortunately, I really do wish this was an Air-U rasp, but the Nicholson will take care of business today. Remember, when using a rasp, it's much like a plane. It cuts in one direction, so while it's tempting to push and pull as we use it, you're only getting cutting action in one direction. So pay close attention to that in case you have any bad tear out as a result, because you may be pulling it when you should actually be pushing it. Now, once the fixed shelves are completed and the curves refined, it's time to assemble the corner unit. But because the sides of the unit aren't directly across the shelves from each other, the glue up takes a little more time and a lot more planning and plenty of patience. I apply glue to one set of dados, then fit one end of the shelf into the appropriate position. These shelves are a little awkward to clamp because the other side isn't there to drop into position, then glue and square up. So I instead have to apply the clamps, play with them as much as possible to get square, and then walk away and hope they don't move on me. This is where some of those squares for clamping would have been very helpful. But as you'll see later, the glue up worked and it all came out fine. So that's a good place to stop the first portion of today's episode. And normally it would be a little bit longer, but I'm going to whine a little bit. It's hot out. As I'm recording this video, it is the middle of July and I happen to be in like the second or third day of the heat wave that ended up hitting us. And to be quite honest with you, I'm told I've got like two or three more days left of upper 90s, somewhere into the 100 with the heat index. And in Michigan, that means a lot of humidity. Now, like I said, I'm kind of whining a little bit because I am in a basement workshop and I happen to have the air conditioning running. You can probably hear it a little bit in the background there. So it's not quite so bad for me. But well, when it's hot out, it's hard to get motivated to do anything. But considering the fact that if you've been following along with these episodes as they've been coming out, right, you know, one right after the other, I'm a couple of weeks late getting this episode out. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. For the second half, I want to talk about a couple other ways that we can create the curve that we saw in that corner bookcase. Now, when I started this bookcase build, I had mentioned that we were building a wall of shelves, or I should say the walls of shelves is the name that we were going with. And what it ended up being was I had about 15-inch wide shelves off on one wall. I had two 24-inch wide shelves on a second wall. And right next to that, the client wanted a curved bookshelf so that it would fit right into the corner and tie in with those two 24-inch ones. Now, I hadn't mentioned too much about it because, to be quite honest with you, once I started the build and I started recording it, I was still kind of working out the process of how I was going to do these corner bookshelves, because unlike the other ones, these still need to be adjustable too, like the other ones. But unlike them, I have to figure out how to get those, that adjustability built into it. But the first thing I need to do is to get those curves so that I can get the shelves made and then worry about the adjustability in it. Once I had that all worked out, it was pretty easy to take care of. And as you saw in the video, we ended up using just our jigsaw to create those curves. Now, the jigsaw is not a tool that I use quite often. In fact, probably the way I'm holding it, I hope that doesn't tell people how I would normally end up using it, because I don't use it that way, I swear. But anyways, the jigsaw is a really great tool for any type of cuts where they're going to be curved, whether it's just as simple as that curve that you saw me cut earlier, or even more complicated as kind of like a jigsaw or a puzzle saw type cut where it's really windy and snaking through it. The jigsaw works fantastic for that. And in fact, to be quite honest with you, I think a jigsaw could be considered an essential tool in any wood shop, because there are going to be times when you'd be working with material that's far too big to take to another option, which would be the bandsaw. Now, typically the bandsaw is the tool that I think to go to the most when it comes to curved cuts. After all, we have a nice sized motor, depending on which one we have, but even some of the benchtop ones, you can still do quite a bit of curved cuts with it in some of the most common material you work with, especially 3/4 inch material. Even with some of the hardwoods, you put a really nice blade on that, and even those small benchtop models, they will cut through it like it's nothing. But when you get to a larger one like this 14 inch, well, let me tell you something, this can be a real workhorse. And of course, the main thing is being able to do those curved cuts, because unlike a traditional table saw, and just for the record, I've got this completely turned off, so let's go ahead and lift this up. The nice thing with the bandsaw is the fact that we have the blade, and the blade, of course, is in the shape of a band, hence the name bandsaw. And as we're using our material and we're pushing it through, because there's not that big blade, again, like you would have on a table saw, it's easy to get the material in there and to start to make the cuts and make those curves. The most important thing when creating a curve on a bandsaw is to use the right size blade. Now, this one happens to be a resawing blade that I have on here, and it's rather a narrow resaw blade. This is my wood slicer, and it comes in at about 1/2 inch. So when it comes to the diameter of a curve, that's gotta be a pretty big curve.
So for the curve that we created for the bookshelf, I would actually probably want to go down to maybe more like a quarter inch or even 3/8 of an inch. The 3/8 I think would probably really be pushing it. Quarter inch for sure. Absolutely, if I went down to an eighth of an inch bandsaw blade, that one gives us more of like a scroll saw kind of an action. But that quarter inch, we would have no problem at all creating the curve that we want on the bookshelf. But we do run into one issue. Now, I had mentioned that this is a 14-inch bandsaw, and if you're not familiar with bandsaws, the size that you get, that 14-inch, actually refers to the distance between the blade and the arm over there. So that tells you that you have approximately 14 inches, which that doesn't quite look right, but that's how wide the material can be. And with that bookshelf we were working with, if I came in and started to make the curve, I could almost come on the backside and hit that arm. So to be quite honest with you, this was one of those things I started thinking, you know, sometimes it's easier to bring the tool to the wood rather than the wood to the tool. And again, that's why I chose my jigsaw. But the jigsaw and the bandsaw, once again, aren't our only options. We do have another option too, which is just simply going to something like, say, a coping saw. Now, when it comes to a more traditional tool like a coping saw, the beauty of this is that it can really get into a nice tight area, well, depending on the size of the frame. But more importantly is the fact that this particular blade, because it's so narrow, works really fantastic at doing some detail work. One thing I would probably do different if I were to choose to use the coping saw, if I really decided that I wanted to go this route, as you saw when we were creating those straight cuts to get to the curve and then we stopped, well, rather than leaving that material, what I would probably do is actually come back in and cut right to where I finished that cut. So in other words, I would remove most of the waste and leave just a little bit so that I could just get right in there and make the cut, go along, and finish it. Once again, though, with the coping saw, it definitely would take a lot of work. And, well, pretty much with like all the other methods we're talking about, the jigsaw, the bandsaw, now the coping saw, once we finished that cut, we'd have to come back in and refine it also. Now, when it comes to the refining process, is using a rasp or, say, a file or even maybe some sandpaper on a dowel the only choice that we have? I mean, that's a lot of work. That is actually throwing out probably just as much sawdust into the air as, say, a power tool. So if that's the situation, maybe we might want to use a power tool. So to finish that cut, since we've made the rough cut with either, again, jigsaw, bandsaw, or say the coping saw here, we could potentially use our router and perhaps maybe a pattern to go ahead and clean up the marks that are left by whichever saw we choose to cut out that area. This gets into the idea of pattern cutting, and we've talked about pattern cutting here actually a long time ago. We talked about it. It's probably maybe a subject that we need to come back to, because there's a few things we need to be cautious about when we're doing a pattern cutting, because like any time we're working with our wood, we really need to pay attention to the grain, number one, so it doesn't kick back at us, and number two, so that we don't end up tearing it out and just making a really beautiful cut into something that's horrendous. But we could always head over to the router table or just take our freehand router and use that with a pattern to get the result that we want. So let's talk about that just for a few seconds, and then we'll wrap up the show. If you choose to use a router to refine that curve, one thing that you have to do is you have to create a pattern of some sort. Now, in my particular situation, what I ended up doing, and you saw this in the video, is I took the first shelf that I had created and I refined that corner, that nice curve in there, so that it was exactly how I wanted it. And in fact, what you ended up seeing as I transferred that curve to the next piece was the original one that I did. So it was really easy, because all I had to do was just run the pencil along it and I was able to get this shape onto the next one. But if I was, say, to be using a router, well, I wouldn't want to use that first one as my template, as my pattern on there, because I'm going to be running them up against router bits like this. Now, we have really two choices, at least that I'm aware of, when it comes to using a pattern to refine that shape. This is actually a pattern router bit. Within this particular situation, we have the bearing is at the top of the shank and kind of it'd be in the middle of the whole entire router bit itself. One thing I like about this is the cutters themselves are actually, trying to get some close-ups of this, the cutters themselves are actually pretty good size, and they are also, the tip of them is up above the bearing. That's really nice because when the pattern is registering against this, it gives me a little bit more play for where the cutters are actually going to engage the material I'm working with. In this situation, this is just a regular straight flush trimming bit. And of course, the bearing is at the top. And in this situation, again, we'll try to get some good pictures of this, the cutters run right pretty much up against that bearing. So it doesn't give you quite as much wiggle room as the pattern one does. This straight flush trimming bit actually will give you a little bit cleaner cut than this pattern one. But to be quite honest with you, regardless of which one I'm using, chances are more than likely I'm going to come in with a little sandpaper and just clean it up regardless of how clean it feels when I do it. But when it comes to using that pattern, as I mentioned, one of the things is you don't want to use your original that you've refined, if you have an original piece, as in my situation, had an original shelf, I was using that to transfer it, you don't want to use that for your router, so you'd have to create a pattern. And when it comes to using that pattern, as I mentioned, you need to be considering kickback, because if you're using a solid wood, remember, you're still messing with grain direction. So as you are feeding that in the router table, or if you're doing it by hand, you could potentially start tearing out that wood, or again, you could hit a nice little area that could cause a little kickback, and then your piece is pretty much all messed up. Like I said, we'll come back and we'll talk a little bit more about maybe using patterns, or I'll try and find links to the shows that we've talked about in the past. I know it's been a few years, and we will definitely come back and talk about that. But when it comes to using the router, it's not one that you're going to be able to cut the curve out with. It's particularly only for refining. And again, just simply come in with some sandpaper and you can clean it up right afterwards. One more tool that I forgot to mention, and I didn't use it in this particular build, but you could also use a spoke shave when it comes to refining the curve. Can't cut a curve with it, but you can refine the curve, and that's a nice way to go. So I think that pretty much covers the main tools that I can think of for trying to create these curves. If you have any suggestions, maybe a bow saw. I know our friend Shannon Rogers, as we're recording this, has just done a really great episode on creating a bow saw using a Gramercy bow saw kit. That's something we could definitely check out, although I think I probably would do something very similar as I did with the coping saw, but I don't have one, so I can't tell you for sure exactly that's what I would do, but I think it's probably a good start. Anyways, though, I think that's pretty much going to do it. If you have any comments or questions or a suggestion about another option, I would love to hear it, and I know everybody else would too. Make sure you send that in to mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Of course, you can also stop over at our website, which is mattsbasementworkshop.com, and you can leave a comment in today's show notes or on any of the show notes that you see throughout the whole entire website, any blog post or any previous episode. Would love to hear from you. Of course, you can find us over on Facebook and Twitter and now Google Plus also. So I think that's pretty much going to do it. We'll be talking to all of you very soon. The next episode, we're going to completely wrap up this build. We've got a little veneering to do, and we'll have all of that from the bookshelf, from the shelves themselves to the carcass. And I'll share a few tips with you on how I got those veneers to pretty much look like they belong right on there as if it was solid wood. I was pretty happy with the results I got from it, and I'll be more than happy to share that with you. So until the next time, I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.